It's Torah talk. It's Torah talk. It's Torah talk. It's Torah talk. It's Torah talk.
We are witnesses and watchmen of Torah.
Welcome to Torah Talk with Lew White and Mark Davidson.
A Torah Institute podcast.
It's the Torah Zone.
G'day, brother. How you going?
Oh, hi. I'm fine. Who are you? This is Mark Davidson, and my name is Lew White.
Fantastic.
You know, a lot of people, yeah. When I was watching Chris on the video, the first episode, I really didn't know what Chris looked like, and I was wondering who it was, even though I didn't read the text all the way at the beginning. I just clicked on it, and maybe it would be good if we introduced ourselves. Each time.
Oh, lovely.
You know, you want to do it now?
Good idea.
And maybe we can patch it over?
Yeah.
Okay.
Brothers and sisters, my name's Mark Davidson, and welcome to Torah Talk. And I have the privilege every fortnight, don't ask me why, of getting to talk to this amazing man here, Lew White.
Hello. How you doing, Mark?
I'm good, thanks, mate.
Thank you. Good to see you.
Amazing. Yeah.
Yeah. Well, you know, it'd be interesting. Before we start these, I privately have a prayer to Yahusha that he guide everyone, including yourself, and that whatever it is that he wants to teach us, that's the thing that people will hear, you know, because we're just going to use scripture, you know. And it's a wonderful thing that he's revealed this at this time. The two resurrections and the two destinations. Have you got that on your screen there for us to kind of go through?
Yes. It's very important, isn't it?
Oh, absolutely. To our expectations, our hope, if we wrap it up in error, then we can be let down and lose faith. A lot of people lose faith easily because their expectations are not being fulfilled because they've been taught something that's not true. Malachi chapter 3 at the end, and the beginning of Malachi chapter 4, and all the way through to the end. Those two are not well understood, you know, because they understand a rapture thing coming, and we're going to discuss a little of that, you know. So anyway, what do you want to start with? The first part of the slides that we prepared?
Sure. Also, I wanted to ask you, when you brought out, because you brought out a seminar, this came to you through a process of seminars, didn't it? You did a seminar about first fruits, and then you did a seminar about resurrections, and then you sensed that people sort of weren't grasping the point, so you pushed them all together, didn't you, and refined it. Did you find that this was original to you? Had you read anybody else's work or teaching that had touched on these subjects, or were you just basically up against a rapture theory?
Well, Yahusha basically guides me in the area of strongholds. That's what I try, and that's why people are so angry with me that are teachers, because I'm tearing down their teachings, and I'm not using it, my opinion. I love them, and I'm sorry that they don't have the correct facts, but no, I had not actually done that. I basically did use parts of other seminars, but each of the truths was based upon foundational scriptures, and I was seeing very early on, 30 years ago, that the processes that people were being taught were different than what was real in the scriptures. Because I always considered scripture reality, the truth. And so the truth and what they were being taught was two different things. So I wanted to find out how I could get it all packaged together, you know, and explain it to them, you know.
Oh, wonderful.
Well, you know, it's just rebellion against his words. And the footnotes and the circus fathers and all the things that seem to, well, you know, the adversary is running the circus. So mm-hmm. he would naturally divert worship to himself through the false name L-O-R-D, you know. Mm-hmm. Who's that? You know, well, it's the adversary, you know. People don't mm-hmm. know that Satan is the Lord. They aren't told that, you know. Most of the people that are hearing this for the first time are thinking, what? But, you know, they have to go back and study scripture and the translations. But the obedient people are the ones that Yahusha is going to say, well done, you know, not the people who just believed. Because, see, the Greek mindset is a distortion of the truth. We don't just believe, we obey as well as belief, yeah. you know.
Yeah.
Anyway.
So this would be a perfect spot to continue with, because in our sort of second season, I'm calling it the second season because our first season of Torah Talks was just sort of getting to know each other and discussing all sorts of random topics. With our second season, it's like a TV show, with our second season, we've sort of gone from the name, then we've gone to repentance, the covenant, immersion, and we're pretty much up to the two resurrections now, which is pretty vital for a next step once you've taken all those other steps to sort of see, well, what do I do now? Where am I heading? What have I got to do? What have I got to overcome? And otherwise, I'm just immersed and I can do what I want. And that's not the go.
Well, the two resurrections, though, if we want to just jump into those things, people are going to say, what's he mean, two resurrections? They associate the idea of resurrection with the rapture. That's the Latin word, raptus. And they have no real idea that there's going to be two resurrections. Because even today, people are listening to radios and TV shows with teachers saying that at the end of the 1,000 years, the millennium, there's going to be the great white throne judgment. And that's correct. But they say that all of those people that are raised are going to be thrown into the lake of fire. We're going to show scripture today that is going to show that that's not exactly true. Because a great many will be found worthy. They're just not worthy of the first resurrection. See, the first fruits are the first resurrection. That's why they're called the first fruits, you know. In fact, the seven festivals that we see on our screen here, the diagram that we've made with the menorah, the seven lampstands, depict the seven appointed times of Israel's redemption. And one of those is first fruits, which would be the resurrection of the first fruits, you know. So the redemption, it's all about the redemption plan. You know, we have to understand his plan, because I think it's in Yeshayahu, where Isaiah says, my word that I've sent into the world will produce that which, you know, I've sent it for. And of course, his word is all about the redemption of Israel, you know. So as long as people know who Israel is, you know, the people in a covenant with him, you know. But anyway, the previously shadowed redemptive festivals, Passover, unleavened bread, and first fruits, being the resurrection of Yahusha, is the first fruits being in that week of matzah or unleavened bread. That was the first fruits of all the harvest of mankind, being that one redeemer. He himself foreshadowed our own redemption by his resurrection, see? And then Shavuot, the outpouring, comes. That's the fourth redemptive festival, or Pentecost is what they call it. And then coming right after that is the last three, and that's the unfulfilled three that are still shadows of things to come that are yet ahead of us. And those would be trumpets, and that's called Yom Teruah, the day of the shout. And that's referred to by Shaul, or Paul, in the scriptures too. You know, at the last trump, the archangel will come down with a blast of a shofar and a shout. And then we have atonement, the day of atonement, and then tabernacles. So those three are still unfulfilled. So we have trumpets where the dead are raised, and those that are alive or changed that are in the first fruits group. And they're the virgins that are mentioned in the Book of Remembrance, not the Scroll of Life. So people don't even remember that, because in Malachi, it talks about Yahuwah has a special treasure. He calls them his jewels that will be protected, you know. And that's where the Christians get their rapture idea. And they're not far off. It's just a matter of timing. But and then Yom Kippur, which is the Day of Atonement, which is, I think, more or less pointing to the Great White Throne Judgment, where the Day of Atonement is the 10th day of the 10 days of awe. And the 10 days of awe kind of foreshadow the millennium, you know. And then there's the Sukkoth, you know, the great last day. Because, see, all of time is wrapped up in a seven-day week of 7,000 years. And the 7,000 years is the millennium, which is a Sabbath, you know, being rest from the dragon, you know. So let's move forward to the next one. Now, let's see, it's telling us that, there's a distinction between those that are saved and these, the first fruits, being that there's many messianics devouring one another all over with strife and rivalry, and they don't have a lot of love right now, but that's being ironed out. I think the bride is going to be pursued by Yahusha, so that they will ultimately see the great salvation or deliverance that he has paid for them. And they have to forgive one another and overcome this separation, you know, from one another. They need to get together. And the first resurrection would be at the coming or the return of Yahusha. And those are going to be those that are without guile and possess the fruit of the Spirit. And they're going to go into the wedding feast. And they're a very special group. They're a select few group. There's not many in the group. We'd like to know exactly how many. I mean, we could say, well, that's the 144,000. And it certainly does point to that, because Revelation talks about those who obey the commandments of Elohim and hold to the testimony of Yahusha. And they are said to be 144,000. But it's all about the wedding feast. And the wedding feast starts at the millennium's beginning. That's the first resurrection. The wedding feast isn't at the end of the millennium. It's at the beginning. And this elite force, or this group, are the wise managers, or the wise virgins, that are ready. The ones that aren't ready are still going to be okay, but they're going to remain unable to come into the wedding feast. But they will await the Great White Throne Judgment, and then they'll be okay. So they're unwise because they haven't prepared. But there's another seminar on that topic. Anyway, the wise managers are mentioned in a parable, and they're the overcomers, they're the wise virgins. And they feed the household in the proper way, and they do so without guile or selfishness, and they teach love and unity. So Yahusha, being coming soon, he would make a distinction between those who love and those who do not. Just like he said in Malachi, he's going to make sure that the distinction between those who obey Yahuwah and those who do not obey, there's a bright line of distinction between them, so that the people that are in the wedding feast will be easily distinguishable, you know. The impact of the wise managers is going to produce not division, but unity and love. But those that are not of the wise managers are teaching the household anger and strife and division. You know, that's pretty apparent. Now, the Great White Throne Judgment is the second resurrection, and that's the judgment, the fulfillment of Yom Kippur, you know, the Day of Atonement, leading up to the arrival of the booth of Yahuwah, the New Jerusalem. Those who know they missed the first resurrection will be fully comprehending the days of awe and the necessity of their name appearing in the Scroll of Life. See, the first fruits have their name written in the Book of Remembrance, you know, referred to in Malachi. The Book of Remembrance is a special treasured possession of those who thought upon his name and spoke to one another, you know. And the Christians are not speaking to one another about his name. They're not meditating upon his name. They're actually saying, well, he knows my heart, you know. Well, that might be, yeah. Anyway, the days of awe will be the time between the two resurrections as Yahusha, let me move something here. As Yahusha reigns here on earth, and he's going to reign through those wise managers, the overcomers, and teach the nations his Torah. Competing doctrines will not be there to distract, and the dragon will be bound. So to all the way to the very end, they will be delivered through this grand plan of Yahusha. They're going to be, we're looking back at Passover and the resurrection, but they will be looking back at the first resurrection also. That's going to be pretty amazing, you know. In fact, Paul was writing about that, saying, don't be worried about these people who are telling you that the first resurrection has already happened, you know, the resurrection of the saints, because it hasn't, you know. During the millennial reign, the first resurrection will be passed. Everyone will be more informed about what is coming, and Yahusha will fully inhabit us, so we will be able to clearly explain the plan to those living in their flesh. And we will rule with compassion because we, like Yahusha, have lived in the flesh and have known the troubles that come along with living in the flesh. Most of our closest family and friends will not make the first resurrection, but we still invite them to the wedding feast, which is at the first resurrection. And no matter what byway that we might find them on, you know, the byways are kind of like the religions, you know. So our primary objective is to keep our eyes fixed on what Yahusha wants us to do to help others and not elbow them out of our way as we strive to make it ourselves ahead of them. We're supposed to put others before ourselves. And while somebody's being angry or they're wrestling with something, we put them first and we slowly and patiently work with them, you know. Now, love is something that will win because nothing in creation can stand against love. It's always going to overcome. So the first fruits, the first resurrection, those in the wedding feast, the wise managers, they're all the same kind of ideas. They're all the overcomers, and they're distinct from those that are in the Great White Throne Judgment. Because at the Great White Throne Judgment, the second resurrection, 1,000 years later, there's going to be a scroll of life opened up, and the names must appear in there, or if they're not there, then they're thrown into the lake of fire. So there's a general resurrection at that point. So both the righteous and the wicked are raised. Now, it says we're supposed to teach the Torah. So we should do that. Psalm 37 says, turn away from evil and do good and dwell forever. For Yahuwah loves right ruling and does not forsake his kind ones. His kind ones. Now, his kind ones is a reference to the wise managers. And the kind ones is also those who are going to be enabled to be in something that Paul uses a reference to. I'm going to show you that in just a moment. They shall be guarded forever, but the seed of the wrongdoers is cut off. The righteous shall inherit the earth. We're not going to heaven. We're going to inherit the earth and dwell in it forever. Now, the mouth of the righteous speaks wisdom, and his tongue talks of right ruling. The Torah of his Elohim is in his heart, and his steps do not slide. We have to overcome the old wine. The old wine would be the teachings of men that have programmed our minds and thoughts. But the new wine that Yahusha has to bring to us involves his covenant written upon our hearts, and of course the proper things to look forward to, such as the first resurrection. See, it's called a high calling. Paul calls it the high calling. See, there's a calling, but then the high calling would be the one that's above, and those are the ones that are being called to the wedding feast. Now, in Matthew 22, it says in verse 36, "Teacher, which is the great command in the Torah?" And Yahusha said to him, "You shall love Yahuwah your Elohim with all your heart, with all your being, and with all your mind. This is the first and great command, and the second is like it. You shall love your neighbor as yourself. On these two commands hang all the Torah and the prophets." So that's very important to know, but we have to understand that the covenant is not annulled by those two. They just sort of refine it for us. When we read the 10 words, the 10 commandments, like in Deuteronomy chapter 5 and Shemot through Exodus chapter 20, we're learning how to love Yahuwah and love our neighbor. The first commandment is, I am Yahuwah, your Elohim, who brought you out of the land of Mitzrayim, out of the house of bondage. You have no other mighty ones against my face. You do not make for yourself. Wait just a moment. Okay, you do not make for yourself a carved image, any likeness of which is in the heavens above, or which is in the earth beneath, or which is in the waters under the earth. You do not bow down to them nor serve them. For I, Yahuwah your Elohim, am a jealous El, visiting the crookedness of the fathers upon the children to the third and fourth generations of those who hate me, but showing kindness to thousands, to those who love me and guard my commands. That was the second commandment. The third is, you do not cast, that means to throw, the name of Yahuwah, your Elohim, to ruin. For Yahuwah does not leave him unpunished who casts his name to ruin. The fourth commandment is the covenant sign. Guard the Sabbath day to set it apart as Yahuwah, your Elohim, commanded you. 6 days you labor and shall do all your work, but the seventh day is a Sabbath of Yahuwah, your Elohim. You do not do any work, you nor your son nor your daughter nor your male servant nor your female servant nor your ox nor your donkey nor any of your cattle nor your stranger who is within your gates, so that your male servant and your female servant rest as you do. And you shall remember that you were a slave in the land of Mitzrayim, and that Yahuwah your Elohim brought you out from there by a strong hand and by an outstretched arm. Therefore, Yahuwah your Elohim commanded you to observe the Sabbath day. And we can see that Ezekiel 20, in chapter 20, Ezekiel indicates that this is the sign between Yahuwah and his people. And I think that's mentioned again in Deuteronomy 31. Now, the fifth commandment is respect your father and your mother. Wait a minute. Okay. As Yahuwah, your Elohim, has commanded you, so that your days are prolonged, and so that it is well with you on the soil which Yahuwah, your Elohim, is giving you. Number six, you do not murder. Number seven, you do not break wedlock. Number eight, you do not steal. Number nine, you do not bear false witness against your neighbor. Number 10, you do not covet your neighbor's wife, nor do you desire your neighbor's house, his field, nor his male servant, nor his female servant, his ox, nor his donkey, or whatever belongs to your neighbor. And then we can continue right into the next part. It says, "Hear, O Yisrael, Yahuwah, our Elohim, Yahuwah is one, and you shall love Yahuwah, your Elohim, with all your heart, and with all your being, and with all your might. And these words, which I am commanding you today, shall be in your heart, and you shall impress them upon your children, and shall speak of them when you sit in your house, and when you walk by the way, and when you lie down, and when you rise up, and shall bind them as a sign on your hand, and they shall be as frontlets between your eyes, and you shall write them on the doorposts of your house and on your gates." That's Deuteronomy 6. Anyway, this is the way that we're supposed to walk in. And there's a scripture here that says, let me see, Yeshayahu or Isaiah chapter 30, starting at verse 20, says, "Though Yahuwah gave you the bread of adversity and water of affliction, your teacher shall no longer be hidden, but your eyes shall see your teacher, and your ears hear a word behind you saying, 'This is the way, walk in it,' whenever you turn to the right or whenever you turn to the left." So anyway, the idea though is we're going to be tested, and I think we can feel the test going on. And Yahuwah searches the hearts and the minds. That's the same thing, of his children to discern their motives. And Matthew 10, starting at verse 34, says, "Do not think that I have come to bring peace on earth. I did not come to bring peace, but a sword. For I have come to bring division. A man against his father, a daughter against her mother, and a daughter-in-law against her mother-in-law. And a man's enemies are those of his own household." He means that they will be, because one will have a love for the covenant, and another will not, because they just resist it. And 1 Peter 4:17 says, "Because it is a time for judgment to begin from the house of Elohim. And if firstly from us, what is the end of those who do not obey the good news?" That's the Besorah, or the message of Elohim. "And if the righteous one is scarcely saved, where will the wicked and the sinner appear?" Well, let me guess. In the great white throne judgment. You know? Now that's the answer. Now, Yahuwah's name upon us seals us and protects us. So we have a love for his name. We know what his name is. You know, I mean, if we're in the unwise virgin group, we'd be pounding on the door saying, "Let us in," and he's going to come to the door and say, "Who are you?" You know. Anyway, we're going to have protection, as there was protection in the days that Israel was in Mitzrayim. That's Egypt. If we read Exodus chapter 8, we'll see that there's a separation between the Israelites and the Egyptians. It says in chapter 8, verse 22, it says, "And in that day I shall separate the land of Goshen, in which my people dwell, that no swarms of flies shall be there, so that you know that I am Yahuwah in the midst of the land. And I shall put a distinction between my people and your people. Tomorrow this sign shall be." And Yahuwah did so, and thick swarms of flies came into the house of Pharaoh, and into his servants' houses, and into all the land of Mitzrayim, and the land was ruined because of the swarms of flies. Now, Pharaoh is an interesting character, because that would be an emblem or a symbol of Satan, the dragon. In fact, that's what the serpent, he's called a dragon because that's what the word is in Draco in Latin, and it means serpent. Anyway, the Pharaoh would wear a headdress that was, you remember the King Tut's death mask and the little headdresses that they wore. That was to make them appear to look like a cobra, which is a serpent, because they were serpent kings. Now, and they want us to worship the government, is what they want, because the government is essentially the beast. And the beast system is getting stronger and stronger all the time. That's the United Nations, the efforts to rule the world. And we're not out to rule the world. We want Yahusha to rule the world. You know, they're not promoting Yahusha. They're actually punishing people who worship Yahusha. Now, in Revelation 14, starting at verse 9, it says, "And a third messenger followed them, saying with a loud voice, 'If anyone worships the beast and his image and receives his mark upon his forehead or upon his hand, he also shall drink of the wine of the wrath of Elohim, which is poured out undiluted into the cup of his wrath. And they shall be tortured with fire and sulfur before the set apart messengers and before the Lamb.'" So this is idolatry, you know, to put another person above us would be to worship the government, or worshiping anything but Yahuwah. Because the government of men would be idolatry. Now, witchcraft is practiced under every green tree on the planet. And we've shown that with the Christmas seminar. But in Yirmiyahu, or Jeremiah chapter 2, verse 20, it says, For of old you have broken your yoke and tore off your bonds. And you said, I am not serving you. When on every high hill and under every green tree you lay down a whore. Yet I have planted you a choice vine, all of it a true seed. How then have you turned before me into the degenerate plant of a strange vine? So we're told to come out of her, my people, which is all the witchcraft. Now, we're going to go back to the heavenly calling, or to come out, to clean up the bride. We have to come out of her. Revelation 18, starting at verse 4, says, "And I heard another voice from the heavens saying, come out of her, my people, lest you share in her sins and lest you receive of her plagues." Because her sins have piled up to reach the heaven, and Elohim has remembered her unrighteousnesses. So the overcomers are basically yelling and saying, hey, there's pagan stuff going on here. You know, what's going on? Let's not do that. You know, but they're blind and sleeping, and, well, that's what they are. They're dreaming. But that word heavenly calling that we talked about earlier, that's something that Paul talked about. It's a high calling. And it's a kind of a code word. There's a lot of code words. And it's a heavenly calling to the marriage supper of the Lamb. That's what we're being called to. He wants everyone to come. And he sends out people to go get the friends and the relatives. And the friends and the relatives, they say, whoops, I'm a little busy. He says, what? They're not coming. Well, go out and get somebody else. Go get these people that are like over here. We don't even know who they are. Let's bring them in here. You know, and the message is going out. The Besorah is going out. And they say, well, okay. Some of them come, some of them don't. Then he says, well, look, it's not full enough. Let's get some more. So he sends them out and he says, look, pick people up. I don't care who they are, how dirty they are. Get them. Go out there and grab them. So we're out there doing that. And we're saying, boy, you're really a mess. But I'd like to tell you something. Would you like to come to a wedding supper? And some of them are going to say, wow, I didn't ever think I'd be able to go there. Well, sure, I'm in there. And so they come, you know, and they put on righteousness before they come. You know, the garments of righteousness. The wedding supper is the righteousness of the saints, you know, the clothing, the white robes. And some of them are not going to be cleaned up properly, and they're not going to get it. They're going to get thrown out. But in Hebrews 3, we see something very interesting. Therefore, set apart brothers, partakers of the heavenly calling, closely consider the emissary and high priest of our confession, Messiah Yahusha, who actually, his very first miracle that we have on record was at a wedding festival. Remember when he changed the water into wine? And so anyway, the Christians have a misunderstanding of the processes. They don't. They have a general understanding, but they don't know that there's two resurrections, because they've confused the two of them. They seem to be getting the two things mixed up. Eschatology, which is the Greek word for the extreme end days, is explaining that there's really two resurrections, and the first resurrection is a special resurrection of Yahuwah's treasured possession, and it involves a book of remembrance. Those people are meditating upon the name that's in Malachi chapters 3 and 4, and he notices it, and they're speaking to one another, you know, saying, hey, let's study his name. And then a book of remembrance pops up, but he's not going to reveal his name or give his name to those that are still living in Egypt. You know, if you're not going to repent and return to his covenant, then he's not going to make his name mean a thing to you. He's gonna have you saying, well, it doesn't really matter what we call him. I mean, he's got thousands of names. Let me show you. You know, they open up the book and they've got a page where it lists the names of G-O-D. What? You know, but they can't find anything like that in the text. Anyway, the book of remembrance involves the first fruits, and that would be the first resurrection, those going to the wedding feast. And they're also called wise managers. They're the remnant. They're the chosen ones, the overcomers. And he also calls them my kind ones. The millennium is the 1,000 years. And there's at the end of that, there's the general resurrection at the great white throne judgment. And it involves the scroll of life. See? Now, the book of remembrance, let's think about that. Let's read a little bit about that in Malachi chapter 3. Starting at verse 16, it says, then those who fear Yahuwah speak to one another, and Yahuwah listen and hear and a book of remembrance be written before him of those who fear Yahuwah and those who think upon his name. And they shall be mine, said Yahuwah of hosts, on the day that I prepare a treasured possession, and I shall spare them as a man spares his own son who serves him. Then you shall see the difference between the righteous and the wrong, between one who serves Elohim and one who does not serve him. That's pretty amazing. Now, the marriage supper of the Lamb is the first resurrection, and it's described again in Revelation 19. At verse 7, we read, "Let us be glad and rejoice and give him praise, for the marriage of the Lamb has come, and his wife prepared herself. And to her it was given to be dressed in fine linen, clean and bright, for the fine linen is the righteousnesses of the set apart ones. And he said to me, Write, blessed are those who have been called to the marriage supper of the Lamb. And he said to me, These are the true words of Elohim. Now that's at the time the dragon is seized for 1,000 years. And Mark 14 says, Truly, I say to you, I shall certainly no more drink of the fruit of the vine till that day when I drink it anew in the reign of Elohim. And then he's going to be there at the beginning when he returns. See, a lot of Christians think we're just going to get snatched away, a bride, and we're going to be in heaven with him. But that's not what Scripture says. It says he's coming here, and we're going to be caught up with him as he's coming back, and the dead raised first, and then those that are yet alive, and the first resurrection. That's pretty exciting to know. But of course, we understand that's going to be in a process that's a little different from what most people see. We'll look at that in a few moments. In the scriptures, in Numbers chapter 10, it describes how one trumpet is blasted, and then there's a two-trumpet thing going on. And Yahuwah spoke to Moshe, saying, Make 2 silver trumpets for yourself. Make them of beaten work, and you shall use them for calling the congregation and for breaking camp. And when they blow both of them, all of the congregation comes to meet before you at the door of the tent of meeting. Now, that would be when all the people are called. That's the great white throne judgment at the end of the millennium. Now, and if they blow one, then the leaders, that's the wise managers, the heads of the thousands of Israel shall gather to you. See, so there's only going to be one trump at his return. That means that one trumpet is going to blast, and it's only going to call the wise managers. And the rest of the people are going to be going, What? I didn't make it? You know, we've got to understand this in order that we don't lose heart. Now, one trumpet summons the managers, which are the heads, the overcomers, gathering at the sound of a trumpet. You know, Matthew 24 talks about the one trumpet. And immediately after the distress, now did you notice that it said after the distress? That's after the tribulation. Of those days, the sun shall be darkened, and the moon shall not give its light, and the stars shall fall from the heaven, and the powers of the heaven shall be shaken. And then the sign of the Son of Adam shall appear in the heaven, and then all the tribes of the earth shall mourn, and they shall see the Son of Adam coming on the clouds of the heaven with power and much esteem, and he shall send his messengers with a great sound of a trumpet, and they shall gather together his chosen ones from the four winds, from one end of the heavens to the other. Now that's saying that it's after the tribulation. Okay, we're going to see the process a little more detailed a little later. But that's what he said. Now, Yom Teruah is the day of the shout. Most Christians have never heard of Yom Teruah. That's in the 7 annual or, you know, yearly festivals, which are shadow pictures of the redemption of Israel. The first day of the 7th moon in the Hebrew calendar is a shadow of the first resurrection. That's what it is. So we have to do all things in their proper order. 1 Thessalonians 4 is misunderstood unless you understand the context of what we just studied. In starting in 1 Thessalonians 4, chapter 4, verse 13. Now, brothers, We do not wish you to be ignorant concerning those who have fallen asleep, lest you be sad as others who have no expectation. For if we believe that Yahusha died and rose again, so also Elohim shall bring with him those who sleep in Yahusha. For this we say to you by the word of the Master, that we, the living, who are left over at the coming of the Master, shall in no way go before those who are asleep. Because the Master himself shall come down from heaven with a shout, with the voice of a chief messenger, and with the trumpet of Elohim, and the dead in Messiah shall rise first. Then we, the living, who are left over, shall be caught away together with them in the clouds to meet the Master in the air. So we shall always be with the Master. So then encourage one another with these words. Now the first resurrection is what we just heard described. Now that is what the Christians call the rapture. However, its timing is not understood, because it isn't before the tribulation. Yahusha himself said so. Now in 1 Corinthians chapter 15, we read this. See, I speak a secret to you. We shall not all sleep, but we shall all be changed in a moment, in the twinkling of an eye, at the last trumpet. For the trumpet shall sound, and the dead shall be raised incorruptible, and we shall be changed. For this incorruptible has to put on incorruption, and this mortal to put on immortality. And when this corruptible has put on incorruption, and this mortal has put on immortality, then shall come to be the word that has been written. Let me read that. Death is swallowed up in overcoming. And that's quoting Yeshayahu or Isaiah chapter 25, verse 8. Did you want to say anything that may be on your mind, Mark, at this point?
No, everything's great, mate. You've got a lot of slides to get through. I'm just staying out of the way.
Oh, well, we're about halfway done. But people blur the two resurrections into one. They just fail to see it. They think that that text is talking about everyone that believes. It's not. It's talking about the wise managers that are called at the first trump, you know, just like we looked at in Numbers chapter 10. Now, Luke 12, starting at verse 40, says, "And you, then, be ready, for the Son of Adam is coming at an hour you do not expect." And Cephas said to him, "Master, do you speak this parable to us or also to all?" Now, that's a good question to ask. He was inspired to ask that. Now, here's the answer. And the Master said, "Who then is the trustworthy and wise manager whom his master shall appoint over his household to give the portion of food," that's teachings, "in due season? Blessed is that servant whom his master shall find so doing when he comes." Now, that's just blazing wisdom right there, you know, in the context that we are looking at. People blur these two resurrections because here's what the remnant is going to be faced with in the first resurrection. Only first fruits, the first fruits dead, are raised at one trumpet, followed by those alive in Mashiach, gathered to meet Yahusha in the air as he returns, and they reign with him for 1,000 years. And of course, we're teaching. You know, the flesh that's left over reproduces, and they're being taught about all that's been before and what lies ahead. So they're going to have a real advantage because the dragon won't be there. Now, in the second resurrection, this is at the end of the millennial reign. That's at the end of the 1,000 years. All the dead are raised. That's what Peter was talking about when he said, "Do you say this to us or to all?" See? See, Yahusha is very distinct. Now, all the dead are raised at the second great white throne judgment, and those whose names are in the scroll of life inherit life. Those not in the scroll are cast alive into the lake of fire with the dragon and his malakim, the beast and the false prophet. Actually, the beast and the false prophet are the first to go into the lake of fire at Yahusha's coming. That's one of the things we'll find out later too. Because the beast and the false prophet are already in the lake of fire for 1,000 years before the dragon gets put there. So the Christians that are being taught by the leaders that somebody might or might not be in hell, they're wrong. Because the lake of fire, no one goes into the lake of fire except for the beast and the false prophet at Yahusha's return. So nobody's in the lake of fire yet. And then at the end of 1,000 years, a whole lot of people and Malachim and the dragon will go in. Because see, the dragon's not going into the lake of fire. He's not there now. You know, a lot of people think that's where he is because they're taught by sound bites. Now, in the prophet Joel, his real name is Yael, chapter 2, 32, it says, "And it shall be that everyone who calls on the name of Yahuwah shall be delivered. For on Mount Sion and in Jerusalem there shall be an escape, as Yahuwah has said, and among the survivors whom Yahuwah calls." Now, the 12 tribal elders that we read about, that would be the sons of Jacob. You know, the 12 sons of Jacob through the four women. We have them, and we have 12 disciples. So the 12 disciples are going to be named along with the tribes of Israel. When you read about the New Jerusalem and the 12 gates, there's things going on. The gates are named for the tribes. And then the foundation stones that are under those gates are named for the disciples. So we've got 24 elders there, which is really cool because there's 24 courses of priests too. Now, Revelation 5 says, "And when he took the scroll, the four living creatures and the 24 elders fell down before the Lamb, each holding a harp and golden bowls filled with incense, which are the prayers of the set apart ones. And they sang a renewed song, saying, 'You are worthy to take the scroll and to open its seals, because you were slain and have redeemed us to Elohim by your blood out of every tribe and tongue and people and nation, and made us sovereigns and priests to our Elohim, and we shall reign upon the earth.'" Now that implies the nations are descended from those 12 tribes. I mean, those, you know, the tribes of Israel, because we are. All the people on the earth are descended from those 12 tribes because he's mixed them up. Amos 9 verse 9 tells us that he mixed them in to the Gentiles. And now he's calling them out one by one. Come to the wedding feast. We have to have fun at this too. I mean, it's not a miserable thing. It's awesome. It's a wonderful opportunity to be called to call others. Now, these people that we're talking about will watch the seals opened. Now, the seals of the scroll of life. And then the trumpets, and then the bowls are poured forth. So, the 24 elders' leadership during the millennium is going to be pretty awesome. We'll be under them, you know, if we are in the first fruits group. Now, Paul is, I would think, one of those because, you know, we would, I mean, like to think so because he was a pretty fantastic apostle. So we have, of the others, we have the descendants of Israel, or Yisrael, Yaakov. They'll be the other 12. So we have 12 apostles and we have 12
tribal leaders,
yeah. So the witnesses of the resurrection are what we're talking about, the people that witnessed his resurrection. Now there's another kind of leadership that we probably need to look at, and that's the mistress of sorceries. There's a woman called the mistress of sorceries in the scriptures. The central Roman beast leadership is certainly reflecting that. It's a Babylonian descent. It's satanic. Anyway, Revelation 18:4 says, "And I heard another voice from the heaven saying, 'Come out of her, my people, lest you share in her sins, and lest you receive of her plagues.'" And of course, that's the mother circus. You know, she even calls herself the mother circus. Only she uses the word C-H-U-R-C-H. And most people have no idea that they're looking at open rebellion when they go to some place like Rome or Washington, D.C., for that matter. You see all this Roman motif and you see these obelisks, which are old Babylonian symbols or images of the beast. And they don't even see the open rebellion. They've been programmed to think that that stuff is great. Now, Shaul, or Paul, actually was unsure of his high, of the high calling. Now, that high calling is a code word for, as we mentioned, the first resurrection. Now, let's look at Philippians chapter 3, verse starting at verse 10. To know him, that's Yahusha, and the power of his resurrection, and the fellowship of his sufferings, being conformed to his death, if somehow I might attain to the resurrection from the dead. Not that I have already received or already have been perfected, but I press on to lay hold of that for which Messiah Yahusha has also laid hold of me. Brothers, I do not count myself to have laid hold of it yet, but only this, forgetting what is behind and reaching out for what lies ahead, I press on toward the goal for the prize of the high calling of Elohim in Messiah Yahusha. As many, then, as are perfect, should have this mind. And if you think differently in any respect, Elohim shall also reveal this to you. See, he's referring to the first resurrection. He's not doubting his salvation. He just doesn't know if he's going to be in the first resurrection, which is so amazing, because we all look up to Paul as a leader. He's taught us so much. Now, the first resurrection is an elite group. These are the first fruits, according to Revelation 14:4, those obeying the commands of Yahuwah and holding to the testimony of Yahusha. And this is the elite group mentioned in Malachi 3:16-18. This automatically eliminates most of the living and the dead. Orthodox rabbis who don't hold to Yahusha and Christians who don't obey the Ten Commandments and all the rest of humanity that disobey or disregard or ignore the covenant and Yahusha's atoning blood offering for their sins. He gave his blood and they don't even care? There's going to be two resurrections, though. That's the thing. The resurrection, the first resurrection in review is the first fruits, the wise managers. They're the ones, and it's a small group. It's not a big group. They're the first fruits. And the second resurrection is going to be at the great white throne judgment 1,000 years later. Now, the first to go into the lake of fire, again, we mentioned, is the beast and the false prophet. And their reign ends at the beginning of the millennium. At the beginning of the millennium, when Yahusha returns, and we are changed, and the dead are raised that are in the first fruits group, the beast and the false prophet are the first to go into the lake of fire. Revelation 20, starting at verse 7, says, "And when the 1,000 years have ended, Satan shall be released from his prison, and they shall go out to lead the nations astray, which are in the four corners of the earth, Gog and Magog, to gather them together for battle, whose number is as the sand of the sea. And they came up over the breadth of the earth and surrounded the camp of the set apart ones and the beloved city." Okay, let's stop for a moment there. It looks like the New Jerusalem is already there. At the end of the millennium, it's already there, as if it has been already there, you know. And that's kind of cool because, you know, in other words, it's like the walls are there. It just doesn't have all the people in there yet, you know. That's kind of cool because we're going to be more or less the framework, the first fruits group and the first resurrection. It'll be kind of like the framework. And then the fire came down from Elohim out of the heaven and consumed them. And the devil who led them astray was thrown into the lake of fire and sulfur, where the beast and the false prophet are. And they shall be tortured day and night forever and ever. And I saw a great white throne, and him who was sitting on it, from whose face the earth and the heaven fled away, and no place was found for them. Now that might be a translational distortion. It sounds as if it's going to be wiped away, but it's just that that's not, you can't even see it because of the blaze, you know, that's great esteem and brilliant light. Now, at that point, all the dead are raised for judgment. And it says, and I saw the dead, small and great, standing before the throne, and books were opened, and another book was opened, which is the book of life. And the dead were judged from what was written in the books, according to their works. And the sea gave up the dead who were in it, and death and the grave gave up the dead who were in them. And they were judged, each one according to his works. And the death and the grave were thrown into the lake of fire. This is the second death. So if anybody says, well, what is the second death? It's the great white throne judgment. First resurrection begins 1,000 years before, and it's the Sabbath. It's a rest. It's like the 7,000 years from the Garden of Eden, and the dragon is bound for that period. Revelation 20 says, and I saw thrones and those that sat upon them, and judgment was given to them, and the lives of those who had been beheaded because of the witness they bore to Yahusha, and because of the word of Elohim. So they witnessed that Yahusha is the Messiah. They also bore in them the word of Elohim, which is the commandments, and who did not worship the beast, nor his image, and did not receive his mark upon their foreheads or upon their hands. And they lived and reigned with Messiah for 1,000 years. And the rest of the dead did not come to life until the 1,000 years were ended. This is the first resurrection. Blessed and set apart is the one having part in the first resurrection. The second death possesses no authority over these, but they shall be priests of Elohim and of Messiah, and shall reign with him 1,000 years. That's the first fruits group. And scripture says there are 144,000. They're also called the remnant. Revelation 12:17 says, and the dragon was enraged with the woman, that's Israel, and he went to fight with the remnant of her seed, those guarding the commands of Elohim and possessing the witness of Yahusha Messiah. And Revelation 14 reflects that same thing. Revelation 14:12. Here is the endurance of the set apart ones. Here are those guarding the commands of Elohim and the belief of Yahusha. So the woman is definitely Israel, or Yisrael, the body of Yahusha, his wife. Now, Yahusha is the head of the body, and we are the body. So if Israel, those in the covenant relationship, obeying his commandments and believing in Yahusha, we're the arms, legs, feet, everything. And we're not supposed, if a finger isn't supposed to look at a toe and say, oh, I'm more important than you. What? Well, we're a body, and we're all connected to the head. And the head is, of course, Yahusha. So, we have to do his commands, you know, and he's our leader. We can't be looking at each other. Now, Revelation 22 also brings up something. In verse 14, blessed are those doing his commands, so that the authority shall be theirs unto the tree of life, and to enter through the gates into the city. But outside are the dogs, and those who enchant with drugs, and those who whore, and the murderers, and the idolaters, and all who love and do falsehood. You know, like if you're coloring little eggs in the springtime, you might want to look into that. You know, and putting little ornaments on trees, you might want to look into that. It says, all who love and do falsehood. You need to find out what those things are. You know, are you eating unclean food? Just saying, well, I don't really care about his commandments. But you should. He wants you to have them written on your hearts. You have to receive a love for them. Now, the mistress of sorceries is referred to in different ways, and it equals the mother of harlots. Revelation 17 talks about a mother of harlots. Revelation 17, and one of the seven messengers who had the seven bowls came and spoke to me, saying to me, come, I shall show you the judgment of the great whore sitting on many waters, with whom the sovereigns of the earth committed whoring, and the inhabitants of the earth were made drunk, and with the wine of her whoring. And he carried me away in the spirit into the wilderness, and I saw a woman sitting on the scarlet beast, on a scarlet beast, covered with names of blasphemy, having seven heads and 10 horns. And the woman was dressed in purple and scarlet and adorned with gold and precious stones and pearls, holding in her hand a golden cup filled with abominations and filthiness and the filthiness of her whoring, and upon her forehead a name written, a secret, Babel the Great, the mother of the horrors and of the abominations of the earth. Now the woman is the mother Circus, mother C-H-U-R-C-H. She calls herself all over the earth by that term, C-H-U-R-C-H. She's known by that name. It is a woman. Revelation 17:18 says, and the woman whom you saw is that great city having sovereignty over the sovereigns of the earth. But we are supposed to ask for the old ways, the ones that the mother does not like us to look at. You don't need to keep those. Well, look at what it says in Jeremiah chapter 6, starting at verse 16. Thus said Yahuwah, stand in the old ways and see, and ask for the old paths, where the good way is, and walk in it, and find rest for yourselves. But they said, we do not walk in it, and I raised up watchmen over you. Watchmen. That's not serene. And said, listen to the sound of the ram's horn. But they said, we do not listen. Therefore hear, you nations, and know, O congregation, what is upon them. Hear, O earth. See, I am bringing evil upon this people, even the fruit of their thoughts, because they have not listened to my words, nor my Torah, and they rejected it. Well, that's what they say.
Hold on. Yeah.
Oh, is it finished or is it still
recording? Did you catch it off? Yeah. Oh, yeah. It's still going. I just wanted to catch it before it cut off.
Well, Mark, he's going to switch that tape. Am I doing all right here?
Oh, wonderful.
I wish you could get in this more. I love it when you. I love it when you go. Hey, what about this? Yeah. You know, I know it's a lot of text.
Yeah. I have a couple of questions. I'm jotting them down as I go.
Are you following the track with me here?
Yes. Have you got the PDF I sent of you?
Oh, yeah. Yeah, that's what I'm using here. And this is I think this is Adobe. Yeah, this is Adobe Reader. Yeah, this is the PDF. It's wonderful. All the emphasis, and you can read everything. That black background really makes a difference.
Yeah. Yeah. Well, we tried the black... The black background came as kind of an accident on the last thing I did this week on the scriptures, the off-the-cuff thing. We used scriptures, and I accidentally reversed it and thought, oh, I like that.
You need back.
Oh, okay.
Yeah. Okay. I'm just saying.
All right.
I'm ready to go ahead and hit it.
Anyway, I was going to say I really enjoyed what Chris had to say.
What about that?
Yeah. Yeah. There's nothing more powerful than the scriptures, you know.
Yeah.
They really, he's bearing down with it, and that's awesome, you know.
Yeah.
Now let's look at those first who will be last. That's an interesting thing. Matthew 19 verse 29 says, "And everyone who has left houses, or brothers, or sisters, or father, or mother, or wife, or children, or lands, for my name's sake." Shall receive a hundredfold and shall inherit everlasting life. But many who are first shall be last, and the last first. So we prioritize our living according to obeying Him, and in spite of what these other people are saying about our doing that, we just simply say, we love you, but I'm going to go ahead and obey Him. That's what I had to do with, you know, my former pastor. I said, well, you know, I still love you, but I'm going to have to obey what the word says rather than doing all this other stuff that doesn't say. And I'm not condemning him. I'm just saying that's, you know, a better thing to do. Now, those who have ordered massacres, they won't be in the first resurrection, but many of their victims will be, you know. So, you know, you can imagine these people that are running around ruling the earth in high places. See, one of the references to the first and the last, the first can be thought of as the people who are empowered in this world, people who have the wealth of the world, and they have the power of the world, and they're all fighting to get up to the top of that pyramid, you know, the pyramid of life, and get up there on that, where that eyeball is. And the last are the people who are the weak ones, the little flock, you know, the ones that have no power. But possessing his word is the greatest treasure of all. Being able to understand his word. Anyway.
That's not hard, is it?
Well, without his spirit, it's impossible. Mm. Yeah. Now, Daniel was told of future resurrections, but he was told to withhold the details. Daniel 12 says, "Now at that time, Michael shall stand up, the great head who is standing over the sons of your people. And there shall be a time of distress, such as never was since there was a nation, until that time. And at that time, your people shall be delivered, everyone who is found written in the book. And many of those who sleep in the dust of the earth wake up, some to everlasting life, and some to reproaches and everlasting abhorrence." See, that sounds like the great white throne judgment. Now, "and those who have insight shall shine like the brightness of the expanse, and those who lead many to righteousness like the stars forever and ever. But you, Daniel, hide the words and seal the book until the time of the end. Many shall diligently search, and knowledge shall increase." So he's really describing the two resurrections right there. You can almost see it. The first part, and then the second part. Now, Daniel is told certain details. Daniel 12, verse 5 starts out saying, "Then I, Daniel, looked and saw two others standing, one on this bank of the river and the other on that bank. And one said to the man dressed in linen, who was above the waters of the river, 'How long until the end of these wonders?' And I heard the man dressed in linen, who was above the waters of the river, and he held up his right hand and his left hand to the heavens, and swore by him who lives forever that it would be for a time, times, and half a time. And when they have ended scattering the power of the set apart people, then all these shall be completed. And I heard, but I did not understand. So I said, 'My master, what is the latter end of these matters?' And he said, 'Go, Daniel, for the words are hidden and sealed until the time of the end. Many shall be cleansed and made white and refined, but the wrong shall do wrong, and none of the wrong shall understand. But those who have insight shall understand, and from the time that which is continual is taken away, and the abomination that lays waste is set up, is 1,290 days. Blessed is the one who is waiting earnestly and comes to the 1,335 days. But you go your way till the end and rest and arise to your lot at the end of days." Now, what about the rapture? What is that about? Well, raptus is the Latin word for seized, from rapire, to seize, in Roman law. And it's a term that was covered, it covered the crimes of property and women who were considered property. The seizing of a bride in an instant. It's the harvest of the earth, too. But it's the bride that's going to get seized. Now, seeing these overcomers, the rest of humanity will submit to these teachers of Torah. Now, those that are seized are going to be Torah teachers. And then, after we're changed, we're going to be pretty distinguishable because we're going to be blazing light. People are going to go, "Whoa, there's one of them." And they're going to say, "Let's listen to what he says because he's right." Because there won't be any errors or dragons deceiving people. So Christians are mistakenly believing that the coming of Yahusha is at the end of all things. You know, that's not the end. When he comes back, big time things are going to happen. The earth is going to be charred, you know, and we're going to go out like calves from the stall and trample upon the people under there. They're going to be ashes under our feet. That doesn't happen at the second resurrection. That happens at the first one. And they believe, also, the Christians believe that there's no more chance for anyone to be saved. Well, the festivals of Yahuwah and their prophetic fulfillment are just not being studied because the circus fathers hated true Yisrael and they hated the Nazarim. They hated us when we were here, and they probably still do. But it's because we have the truth, and we're a problem for their authority, you know, because we're not trying to be an authority. We're just trying to tell people the truth. So many are going to be led to salvation during the Great Tribulation. And that's why we're going to be here during the Great Tribulation, you know. That's an important point. Because why would he take out the only hope that those left behind would ever have? See? Now, when did the current rapture idea begin exactly? The word rapture, as we see, was named, is a Latin word. But I think the Greek word is harpazo. And it means to seize something or snatch it away really quickly. The first use of the word rapture was by a man, as far as we know, religiously speaking, if we can use that word religiously. His name was John Darby, and he first proposed a pre-trib rapture in 1827. The Scottish minister Edward Irving, who died in 1834, just a few years later, promoted three gatherings. First, the first fruits of the harvest, the wise virgins who follow the Lamb whithersoever he goes, and next, the abundant harvest gathered afterwards by God, as he called it, and lastly, the assembling of the wicked for punishment. And this is where the Christians have adopted most of their ideas from these two men, John Darby and Edward Irving. And it started in 1827. Now, the first known theological use of the word rapture, found in print, occurs with the Schofield Reference Bible of 1909. That was the very first time the word rapture was ever read in print. 1909. And that was because of a book that was written in 1908. In 1908, the pre-trib rapture idea was popularized by a best-selling book called Jesus is Coming by William Blackstone. And it sold 1 million copies. And it influenced Schofield's 1909 translation. That was in 1908. In 1909, Schofield's Reference, B-I-B-L-E, came out, and it sold 2 million copies, and it promoted the pre-millennium rapture, and it hyped the sales. In 1957, decades later, a book was written called The Rapture Question, and it sold 65,000. In 1958, the next year, the book called Things to Come sold 215,000. And then in the 1970s, the Late Great Planet Earth book came out, sold 35 million. And then later in the 70s, a movie came out called The Thief in the Night. And it sold 215 million copies. And then from the 1970s through 1995, pretty much nothing happened except everybody was being taught the wrong thing, which a lot of us grew up learning. You know, in 1995, the book Left Behind came out, and it sold tens of millions, plus many movies have spun off from it and other books. So the doctrine of the rapture in its misunderstood condition continues to be an important component in American fundamentalist Christian eschatology. And it's challenging, if you even challenge any part of it, it's akin to heresy. And we've pretty much challenged it now. But here's a graphic breakdown. I'm going to try to widen this a little bit so I can see it better. Oops, okay then. Now there's four popular views from confusion over the first and second resurrections. We have the birth of the Messiah kind of starting out on this graph. And the most popular one is what most people believe, is that, I'm going to start with the truth, The truth is actually the first one. It's the scripturally accurate view. There's the birth of the Messiah, and then at some point there's a tribulation. We're still here, and then Yahusha comes and the millennium begins. That's called the post-trib premillennialism view. Now, the one that's most popular, which is a little flawed, and we're going to continue to in progression as to which ones are more and more flawed. That the first one is the correct one. Now, the next one is the most popular one, and it's the fundamentalist Christian view. They believe that Yahusha was born and then raised and all, and then there's a period of time, and then there's a rapture, and then there's a tribulation, and then there's a second coming, and then there's the millennium, and then there's the last judgment. And that's called the pre-trib, pre-millennialism view. Now, the next one in terms of error, let me see if I can get this. I'm having trouble with this mouse. Alrighty then. Now, in the darker green, no, isn't it? Yeah. Okay, now the next most error-ridden view is the second coming happens after a thousand-year millennium, but there's no rapture at all. It's just a second coming and a last judgment. Now, that's called post-millennialism. So the thousand years of us reigning is actually accomplished by the works of men. Yahusha's not here. He doesn't return until the second coming at the end of the millennium. Now, the most error is found in the last view, and that's called amillennialism, which means there is no real millennium. It's just a figment of your imagination, or it's a symbolic. The word millennial doesn't mean a thousand years. And this is the Catholic view. There's a symbolic millennium, which could be any number of years, which apparently they believe is going on now. And they're forcing their way onto the earth and saying, we're the rain. We can pretty much see that in history. Wow, they were stomping them out, weren't they? All the tortures and killing masses of people, entire cities, some 83 million people just during a 600-year period. And then at the end, there's a second coming and a last judgment. Of course, where people wind up being, they don't really mention, but it's real confusing. But,
the top one is the accurate one.
Yeah. We started with the most accurate one. Now, what is the true timing of the harvest? Well, we can think of the first resurrection as being the harvest. The workers, the wise managers, are our fellow believers working the true message of Torah among men, just as Yonah was sent to Nineveh to teach. They're the wise managers teaching the Besorah. That's the message. The reapers are the messengers, or the malakim, the angels in Greek. And they will first come to take away the offenders. They're not coming to take us away first. They're going to take away the offenders. Matthew 13 gives us this picture. In the harvest, when the days of the harvest come. Now remember, Matthew 13, verse 30. Let both grow together until the harvest. At the time of the harvest, I shall say to the reapers, and the reapers, of course, are the Malachim, the angels, first, gather the darnel, those are the weeds, and bind them in bundles to burn them, but gather the wheat, the chosen ones, into my granary. See, he interprets those in other parts of the scripture. Notice the process again in the words of Yahusha later in the same chapter. Thus it shall be at the end of the age, the messengers shall come forth and separate the wicked out of the midst of the righteous, and shall throw them into the furnace of fire. There shall be wailing and gnashing of teeth. So the end of the age, the Gentiles, the end of the age of the Gentiles, Yahusha reigns with the overcomers. So we have to overcome by not worshiping the government. Because the government is the taskmaster right now. If anybody doesn't notice that, Maybe they ought to just look around and say, what? You know, maybe they are the taskmaster. I can feel it over here. We have the highest tax rate in the world. You know. So they're wanting to dominate us. But here's an illustration, if we can put this up. The wicked are taken out of the midst of the righteous. You know, like that evil cow that's getting taken out of the nice cows down there. Now, let's read it again. Matthew 13, thus it shall be at the end of the age, the messenger shall come forth and separate the wicked out of the midst of the righteous, and shall throw them into the furnace of fire, and there shall be wailing and gnashing of teeth. Now,
so it's actually the opposite.
Yeah, it is.
See? And so when, you actually want to be left behind.
You do. You want to be left behind. Proverbs also, in chapter 2, reveals the very same order of events, starting at verse 20. So walk in the way of goodness and guard the paths of righteousness, for the straight shall dwell in the earth, and the perfect be left in it. But the wrong shall be cut off from the earth, and the treacherous ones plucked out of it. So ask yourself, who is left behind? The straight, the perfect. And who is plucked out of it? The wrong, the treacherous ones. Now, the furnace of testing is a reference to what we're all feeling, because we're enduring a lot of persecution, pressures from the world, and it's going to get a lot worse. In fact, a lot of people are probably going to wind up getting killed, and they are getting killed for their faith. But now, sin is in the Hebraic mind, it's a debt. So when we forgive others their debts, that would be their sins against us, then our debts will likewise be forgiven. If we retain their debts, then our debts will also remain, but it will be because we never knew Yahusha. You know, our love for one another has to be reflecting this forgiveness so we can obtain mercy ourselves. Yahusha is coming soon, and we must endure a time of testing before he does. Now, we're enduring a time of testing now. He's testing our love for one another to see who is to be in the special first fruits group, his treasured possession. And if we don't forgive others, and if we are always causing division and strife and trying to compete, no, you can't use that. You're spelling that wrong. We've got to get over that stuff. Now, death is going to be swallowed up in overcoming. In Yeshayahu, or Isaiah chapter 25, it says, he shall swallow up death forever. And the Master Yahuwah shall wipe away tears from all faces and take away the reproach of his people from all the earth. For Yahuwah has spoken, and it shall be said in that day, see, this is our Elohim. We have waited for him. And he saves us. This is Yahuwah. We have waited for him. Let us be glad and rejoice in his deliverance. Boy, do we look forward to that. See, there he is. In Revelation 19, starting in verse 11, it says, and I saw the heavens opened, and there was a white horse, and he who sat on him was called trustworthy and true. And in righteousness, he judges and fights. And he fights because somebody's been attacking his wife, you know. And his name itself, Yahusha, means Yah is our deliverer. And his eyes were as a flame of fire. And on his head there were many crowns, having a name that had been written, which no one had perceived except himself. And having been dressed in a robe dipped in blood. And his name is called the Word of Yahuwah. Isn't that amazing? That's magnificent. So anyway, the household of faith is actually currently being tested. And the furnace that we're feeling, the fire of the furnace, is that test to eliminate those managers who would attack one another rather than serve the body. So we have to strive to overcome and be counted worthy of the first resurrection. Now, the overcomers are the five wise virgins. And they enter the wedding feast at the first resurrection. The famine of Yahuwah's word that's talked about is Torah rejected and not heard and not obeyed? Amos 8:11 says, "See, the days are coming, declares the Master Yahuwah, that I shall send a hunger in the land, not a hunger for bread, nor a thirst for water, but for hearing the words of Yahuwah. And they shall wander from sea to sea, and from north to east. They shall diligently search, seeking the word of Yahuwah, but they shall not find it." Now that time is past now, because we're right now. Wise managers are out there exposing the truth, and they're going to have to, you know, they're going to have to be the light of the world, because the light is the Torah that's in us, the living word. He's the word. He's the truth and the life. You know, so those that possess that are the wise managers. So that's about the end of what I had to say about it, you know, and scripture in the study of the two resurrections.
So if people are, there's a lot of terms in there that people who have just been freshly immersed and come into Yahusha, a lot of this may go over their head, and that's okay, because you come into it more and more as you learn.
Oh, yeah.
But
good point.
For people who have just come in, like, right now, have just been immersed, what advice do you give them as far as attaining, trying to go for the goal of the first resurrection? And why, if the second resurrection is also deliverance, why is the first resurrection so important? Because people can just say, oh, that's okay. If I don't make the first, I make the second, no big deal.
Well, that's a good question. I feel like it isn't about any one of us wanting to be ahead of someone else. And that big is a big distinction, because when we lay our lives down, there's no greater example than Yahusha gave us, that we lay our life down as a way of appealing to people, so that they are more important than we ourselves are. And I mean to tell you, Paul was one of those, because my discerning of his heart in his words are he would exchange his salvation for the sake of his brothers and sisters, his Israelite brothers. And he said that. And I don't think he was kidding, because this man was not pursuing anything at all for himself. He had given himself. Well, you know, you have to put yourself in his perspective too. He was out there murdering Nazarene. Can you imagine having that on your conscience? You know, and going, well, that's it. You know, without the salvation of Yahusha, he would have been toast, you know. But he knew the salvation. He knew how great the salvation was. And even a wretch like him, having been a murderer of the Nazarene, could be saved, you know. So hopefully not many who are viewing this are murderers, but they're any one of the commandments is the death penalty if you break it, if you don't have it written on your heart, if you just keep striving. So you can see, we're, as Nazarene, it's been explained before in Christianity even, that the life that we lead, if you read Romans 12, it's just falling down and getting up and falling down and getting up, but you're on the path, you know. And we're not to look over at each other when we're stumbling and go, look at you, you're falling down, you know. We're all going to fall down, you know. And that's why we feel like there's hope, you know. And see, without hope, we'll have despair. Hopelessness. But you see, we have the salvation is so great that there's no way that we can not have salvation, because the blood of the Messiah is an infinite value. So you know, we're all okay. And it's, if there had only been one person and that person was you, then he would have still done what he did. He would have come and died for you. But he, you know, that's what's so amazing, you know. But my advice is basically to just keep the faith, keep teaching the truth, learn as much as you can. But it isn't about knowledge. It's about love. So if you ever get to the point where you say, well, I'm going to hit you over the head with all the stuff that I know, and you don't have love, you know, put the other person ahead of you. You're to lift them up. You're, when a brother is looking like they're inferior, we're to help carry them. You know, I've got unbelievers that I pray for, that I work with, and I work and I wait on, and I talk to, and I work with them. And I pray for them. I want to carry them in on my back if I can, you know, to the wedding feast. I don't want to aim them for the second resurrection. I don't think that's a good thing. I mean, you asked that question. I think aiming for the second resurrection might be a bad plan, you know, because the first resurrection is still ahead. And while it's still ahead, we should strive for that, not by works and merit, but by trying to rescue other people, to get them in. Because, you know, those people that are going out into the highways and byways to drag these people in to fill the house, that's who we are, and that's who we want to become. And we know we're going to be okay. We know it in our hearts. We're going out there. You know, why would we be sent if we weren't of the first resurrection? You know, and I just feel that. Not that I'm better. It's just that I want to see his house filled. I want that wedding feast to be a happy time, you know. Yeah. I want it to be a happy time.
If the first resurrection is the wedding feast, it'll be a bit of a non-event if the bride misses the wedding, eh?
Yeah. Or if there was one person that we were supposed to go get and we didn't, because we said, I don't want to work there anymore. It's just too mean and angry or too scary. Well, yeah. You know, in your place or my place, or it doesn't matter where you work, you know, you're out there. If you're not in the world, you're not the light of the world. You're the, what are you supposed to be? The run away from the world and say, oh, those people are dark. We're supposed to hunt them down and look under rocks and go, what are you doing there? Get out of there. We got a wedding feast to get to. Get dressed. And we're getting them dressed by cleaning them up. Come on. You know. You know, and it's a fun job. It's dirty. Yeah. But we have to do it, you know. And it's a fun.
So people who have just been immersed and come into the rain have to understand that there's a big difference between overcoming the world inside yourself and running away from the world. A lot of people think that they're overcoming it by running away from it. It has nothing to do with me anymore. But if you can walk in the world and have it not affect you, that's really what overcoming is, isn't it?
Oh, yeah. Every one of us is standing in stores and businesses and living among neighbors that are murderers, that are thieves, that are Sabbath breakers, that are idolaters, and they're all lost. And they're lost on many levels. And all we have to do is just wake up to it and go, wow, I've got a big job. And we have to reach them. You know, we have to be a light. He'll open up the doorway to reach them, you know, if we're to be used. And in any way that we can, we have to look for an opportunity to explain what our hope is, you know, and why we live the way we live. We're to be distinctive, you know, even while we're among them, you know.
So people who come out of religion could quite... they would come into this experience thinking that it's quite self-indulgent when it's actually the opposite. You repent, you get immersed, you come through the doorway, you're in Israel, now get to work. You know, like, this is not sit back and have a lovely time in your word and just, you know, la-di-da. It's like, okay, here's your tools, get out there and, you know, work. Yeah. That's, we got a job to do.
He's equipped each one of us for a specific type of work. And if somebody looks over at somebody that's working next to them, that's a brother or sister, and they say, whoa, I don't think you should be over there in that place. What? Why not? There's lost people over here, right? Yeah. So we're over there digging around and getting that dirt all churned up and planting that seed. And we just have to do what we're supposed to do, not wonder and worry about what the next guy behind us is doing. Or, you know, like Kepha or Peter was talking to Yahusha after he was resurrected. They were walking away in the last chapter of Yehuchanan or John. And Peter says, well, what about this guy here? What about the writer of this memoir? And he said, you follow me. Don't worry about him. You know, don't put your eyes on him. You just mind me. Keep your eyes on me. That's what Peter was. Peter had a problem of things like that, because when he was walking out of the boat and stepping onto the water, that he was fine. He had his eyes on Yahusha. But when he looked at the wind and the storm, that's when he started to sink. See, we've got to keep our eyes on the task at hand and follow him. Don't worry about the storm. Don't worry about the people in the boat. Don't worry about anybody else. Just do the job that you're given. Walk on water. He'll enable you to do it. And if the other people say, wait a minute, he's getting to walk on water, that's not your job. You know, that's his job. And John, or, you know, Eleazar, the writer of the memoir, he's got something else to do, you know.
Yeah. Yeah, we're going to have to discuss him one episode. That's amazing.
Yeah, he is, isn't he? Mm. Well, a lot of people are wondering how that could possibly be. I don't know. I mean, there's a lot of things that aren't possible, but they're supernaturally possible. Yeah. We're going to be talking about evolution tomorrow at the seminar. Mm. Evolution is, that's impossible, you know. But people believe in it, you know.
Yeah.
Whatever, you know.
I wanted to ask you, when you were talking about the earth and the plan of redemption, the week, 7,000 years, and the Sabbath being the last 1,000 years, that would imply that Yahusha comes back at the beginning of the seventh day, or the end of the sixth day, one or the other. So what year is it? As far as Hebrew, putting all the pagan dates out of the way, what year is it now?
Well, I think it's in the book of Daniel that secret exists, and I think it's somewhere in between the 1290 days and the 1335 days. It's somewhere in there. There's some flexibility there, and I think it's given to be between the Nazarim and the reuniting of the house of Yehuda, because, you know, when Yahusha returns, he's going to be putting the houses back together again. And he's going, instead of having two sticks, he's going to reunite. And Israel will be reunited instead of having this division, you know. But in specifics, though, I have to admit that no one can really emphatically say, I know what year it is, because we are in captivity. That's the real reason why we don't know. We don't exactly, I mean, there's people that will say, I know when the Jubilee is. Well, we might be able to guess, but as far as life and death, no. We're in captivity, and the Jubilee is about the land, you know, and we're not in the land. So while we're scattered, there's going to be a regathering by him, not ourselves. So we have to wait for his regathering, then we'll find out what the date is. I assume, and most people understand, that we're at the end of the 6 days, and night is there, and it's about to dawn the seventh day. Now, people understand the word dawn in different ways. Some believe that dawn means that the day is related to the sun. We're talking about the 1,000 years, you know. The 1,000 years is a day. And that seventh day would have to be indicating that we're at the end, or coming to the close of the sixth day. But as far as what year it is, we would have to be coming upon 6,000 years, you know. Mm-hmm. But in the midst of that, there can be some way for him to supernaturally say, well, it's been slightly more than 6,000 years. That's true. But we're going to be extending that by 30 years or 15 years or whatever it happens to be. And he's going to have a different basis for that, because we don't really have a beginning point that's accurate either, because it could start at the beginning of creation, or it could be that he starts his redemptive plan at the fall, In other words, the time period between creation and the fall. So there's a difference in when that happened. So there could be a 7-year difference or more, you know.
So when you get when you see things online or get emails or things and people say, oh, it's the Hebrew year 5900 and da-di-da, nobody can really know what year it is.
Not really, but you can guess that it's probably approximately true, you know. Approximations is the, I think, the best that we can do, you know, rather than put something in concrete and say, there it is. And then the big disappointment comes and, you know, don't want to set dates, but, you know, that's not our job. I don't know that he's given that job to anyone, really, because private interpretation is usually some deep waters, you know, to be finding yourself in. Because usually there's some people out there that are swimming around and going, hey, there's somebody that knows, let's go over to him. And then he doesn't know, you know. Mm. Because we're supposed to keep our eyes on only one person, that's Yahusha. Mm. We're supposed to be on another job anyway. That's not, he never said there's going to be a need for you to know. He said there's going to be a likelihood that you wouldn't know. But then we do know that there's going to be a season. We will know the season.
Yeah.
But as far as the exact day, well, the exact moment, that's going to be a tough call.
And then he said he might tarry longer because of, doesn't he say that too? If he tarries longer, he'll have to come back, otherwise all flesh will be destroyed. Or
yeah, that's right. Yeah, he does say that.
So it could be longer than the time anyway.
Because he's not willing that any be lost, you know. He wants us to go out and hunt him down. And we haven't really been a concerted effort. His Nazarim are not united yet. We need to get on the same page and stop bickering and fighting among ourselves and looking at one another instead of saying, wow, all these people need help. You know, we've got to go out and do the job. You know, we are the messengers going out into the highways and byways to get these people into that wedding feast. That's what we're here for. If you're a wise manager, the wise managers are the only ones that are going to be in the first resurrection. You know, I mean, if you just go back and review this, you will see. It's only scripture that says that. It's not you or me saying that. It's only scripture that says that.
When you look at the book of Acts and see all the amazing things that happened through Yahusha's emissaries who were with him and how that impacted the world, you can really see that Yahusha's body is not really formed yet, can't you? It's not really, hasn't really happened yet, has it?
I think it's being born, though. I think we're slowly, we're forming in the womb, you know. We're not being born until he actually comes, but that's the rebirth. That's when we put on immortality. But we're in the womb, and we're in there fighting among ourselves. What do you think? This one's called Ping.
Ping.
Hey, Ping. She's a good cat. So that's a good question, though, that you brought up, though.
People need, Yahusha's body needs to come together and realize, like we were saying the other night and like you're saying today, you need to come together and realize that you've got to come into the head.
Oh, I know. Chris's message was spot on. It was wonderful. It was all scripture, you know, and he was just emphasizing every little thing. And, you know, it is necessary that we need to get on task and get busy because the immaturity has got to stop, you know.
Amazing. So we're pretty much looking for the next step is really the sun to go dark, isn't it? Would you say that's the next big eschatological thing to happen?
Yeah. The thing that that's certainly in the picture, and I expect that the storms and the roaring and crashing of the sea and the earthquakes, which is causing the roaring and crashing of the seas, you know, and the fact that the sun is changing its heat patterns and there's some cataclysmic things ahead, catastrophic things that are going to wipe out, you know, well, you know, in that one tsunami, the earthquake that happened in Indonesia, hundreds of thousands of people died just in, you know, one day, in a matter of hours, just wiped away, you know. And volcanoes, there's all sorts of, and things that have, it might hit us from outer space. There's going to be signs, all sorts of signs of the end, and the tribulation is, you know, like, what does he call it? Birth pains? You know, and the birth is, of course, is Israel being born. Israel's, when Israel gets born, the nations are going to be in a lot of turmoil. Well, they are. I mean, they're in turmoil now among themselves. Matthew chapter 24 is all around us, you know.
So brothers and sisters who come into this experience now, into Yahusha, and they can see the truth, maybe they've read Torah or a friend's told them this and they're searching it out, or they've found a copy of Fossilized Customs and they're going, what on earth is this about? The real calling now is to come into love, isn't it? And yes, suffering and rejoicing. Because we're coming into his experience, and his experience was love, suffering, and rejoicing.
Well, the wedding feast is about love. You don't go to a wedding feast ever where there's not like a feeling of the event is defined by love, you know. And if we're whacking each other as we go in the door, hey, you come here, you know, you're not saying his name right, or you know, or you think the day starts at the wrong time, bam. It's just wrong, you know. We don't treat one another that way, you know. And or then there's the other one, the unmentionable. You know, we don't talk about.
Oh, the moon. Sorry.
Sorry.
Well, yeah. We're going to have to work on that moon presentation. I had to take that off YouTube because of all the funky werewolves and stuff. Oh. Copyright protected werewolves.
Oh, are they? Yeah. Use my werewolf. Yeah.
Yeah.
You're going to jail. You really are a werewolf, aren't you? Yes, I am. Anyway, yeah, the heart is a sad place, isn't it? The heart of man. But when we're concerned for our one another and we love one another because he redeemed them. You know? So how in the world can we put our brother or sister down when he shed blood for them, you know? So we have to not do that.
Mm-hmm. Well, that's amazing, brother.
Yeah, well.
Brothers and sisters, stay tuned for another juicy episode of Torah Talk. We don't know where we're going next time.
Well, it's going to be exciting. In a couple of weeks. Yeah.
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 Yeah. You have a wonderful fortnight, mate.
Well, you have a wonderful week and a couple of weeks. Is that a fortnight? 2 weeks?
Yeah.
That's an old school term, you know. We don't usually hear that. Not over here.
Yep, yeah. 2 weeks.
I have looked it up before. It's 2 weeks, yeah. Well, we love you, and I hope you all can share this with others and, you know, so just get a copy of it and back it up and keep studying.
Wonderful.
Okay.
Hallelujah. Love you, mate.
Love you, and we'll see you next time.
We'll do.
All right. Bye-bye.
Bye-bye.